Hello students, having understood the concept of trespass and trespass to persons, now let us move on to the next discussion, which is trespass to goods. Under trespass to goods, we are mainly going to discuss two trespasses to goods. That is first, conversion, and the next is detention. We have already understood that trespass means a direct interference with a person's right. Now, in case of trespass to goods, it is an unlawful disturbance of the possession of good by either seizure or removal or any direct act causing a damage to goods. The plaintiff at the time of trespass has to have a possession of the goods. Now, this possession can either be actual, that is by holding of goods, constructive, that is he should know his goods are under his possession through some authority, or a legal right to immediate possession, that is, under law, he should have a right to immediate possession. The tort of trespass to goods is actionable per se, that is, it is actionable even without the proof of actual damage. If a person's right to possess his good is disturbed, the person can bring about a case of trespass to goods. The essence is that a person who possesses goods as his property has a good title against every stranger, and one who takes them from him has no title in himself and is a wrongdoer and cannot defend himself in such a case. Like in the case of trespass, intention here becomes very important. So if a person wrongfully takes a good, but he has an honest and genuine belief that the good is his own good, he might not be liable for trespass to goods because the intention should be to lawfully disturb the possession. Here, unlawfully disturb the possession. Here, even though the possession was disturbed, it was not done in order to cause damage or harm intentionally. It was a wrongful taken under an honest belief that the good was his own. So, trespass to persons is an unlawful disturbance in the possession, that is, unlawfully disturbing somebody or unlawfully interfering with somebody's right to possess a good. What happens in cases of joint owners, that is, the same good or property is possessed by two persons jointly? Can they bring a case against each other? In this case, if one of the co-owner does any act which results in the ouster of the other co-owner from possessing the good, the co-owner who is so ousted can bring a case against the first owner for trespass to goods because he has interfered with his lawful possession of the goods through seizure or removal or causing any damage to the goods. Let's discuss the case law to more carefully understand what trespass to goods is. The case is Hams versus Darby. In this case, the plaintiff was the owner of certain pigeons, and he released those pigeons so that they could move around a little. Now, these pigeons alighted on the defendant's land and fed on his growing peas. In order to protect the peas, the defendant shot the birds, and this resulted in killing four and wounding one of them. Now, the plaintiff brought an action for damages for the destruction of and the injury to pigeons. The defendant contended that the plaintiff could not have any property in the pigeons. The court held that the plaintiff did have a property in the pigeons, and the plaintiff could bring a case for the destruction and the wounding of the pigeons under trespass to goods. Now, the court held that there was evidence to support the finding that the defendant had failed to prove that there were no practical means other than shooting or stopping the birds from doing the damage to his crops, or that he had acted reasonably in regards to shooting as was necessary to protect the crops, and therefore the plaintiff succeeded in his claim. So hence we understand that any damage of property, wounding of property, destruction of property comes under the tort of trespass to goods. Let us now understand the defenses which a defendant can take in a tort of trespass to goods which is brought against him. The first defense which the plaintiff can take is that the plaintiff himself does not have a right of possession against the owner. That is, the plaintiff himself is not legally authorized to hold the goods in his possession. If this is proved, the case of trespass to goods against the defendant can be set off. The next defense which can be taken by the defendant is that he was authorized by law, or he was under the authority of law or a statute 2. Take possession of the goods. In such cases, he will not be liable for trespass to goods. So, for example, if a person makes a seizure of certain goods under the authority of law, then he is authorized to take those goods and a case of trespass to goods cannot be brought against him. The next remedy available to the defendant is that the plaintiff had created an obstruction. By this, we mean that the plaintiff had kept his goods in such a way that it created an obstruction for the defendant or anybody else. So, and the person had just removed the goods from that place to remove the obstruction. For example, if a plaintiff leaves his cart on the main road and the defendant does nothing more than moving that cart away so as to open the way, it would not be a trespass to goods. Other general defenses, such as the defense of private defense and inevitable accident and so on and so forth, that such as necessity, act of God, etc., which we have already understood and discussed in the previous classes, can also be taken by the defendant in case of a trespass to goods case against him. The remedy in case of a tort of trespass to goods available to the plaintiff is the action for damages. The kind and amount of damages and the quantum would depend on the loss suffered by the plaintiff and the injury done to him. Having understood what trespass to goods is, let's move on to understand what you mean by the tort of conversion, which is a subtype of the trespass to goods. Conversion is defined as an act of willful interference without any lawful justification with any chattel in a manner inconsistent with the right of another, whereby that other is deprived of the use and possession of it. Now, what are the essentials here? That there should be a willful interference. What do we understand by a willful interference? A willful interference implies the element of intention. So understand, in conversion also, intention becomes very important. Now this intention refers to the intentional commission of the act constituting the conversion. So the first essential is that the element of willful interference, that is intention. It should be without a lawful justification. Right? So here also it is subject to certain justifications with any chattel. So with any chattel in such a manner that the person who owns that chattel is deprived of the use and possession of it. So the essence here is deprivation of use and possession of the chattel. Trespass to good was any unlawful disturbance of the possession. Here it is deprivation is of essence here, deprivation of the use and possession of that goods. So this is a qualified trespass to goods. It is a subtype of trespass to goods. What is essential here is that you should understand somebody who treats the goods as if they were his own goods when they are in fact not his own goods is liable to be sued for conversion. So for example, I take away X's book and act as if that is my book, which in fact I know and intentionally took the book to deprive X of the book, then I have committed conversion. Conversion can be done by majorly 6 different methods. We will discuss them in the subsequent discussion. However, there is one common link among all, which is the acts which constitute conversion is that they consist in dealing with the good, which imply either unjustifiable denial of rights of another in them or assertion of rights inconsistent with the rights of another. First, unjustifiable denial of rights of another in them. So for example, I take away X's book. I unjustifiably deny X of the right to use that book. And if I take that book and I assert it to be mine, there is an assertion which is inconsistent with the right of X. I assert something to be my own book, so it is inconsistent with the right of X, right? Because the book is X's and I have taken it away from them. So the two essentials are that there should be a right which is denied to the other, and the right that you assert in the good is inconsistent with the right of the person who holds the right of the goods. Let us look at what the different types of conversion are, that is, the different means and modes by which conversion can be committed. The first and the most simplest is conversion by taking. Anybody who without authority takes possession of another man's goods with the intention of asserting dominion over them commits conversion by taking. What is essential to note here is that the intention should be of asserting dominion over the goods. That is, not every act of taking amounts to a conversion. If somebody merely takes the goods without an intention to exercise either permanent or temporary dominion over them, that is, control over them. So if the person does not want to control or take possession of those goods to keep them as his own, it does not mean conversion. So if I lift up your pen, that doesn't become conversion. However, if I take it with the intention of keeping it with me and exercising a dominion over them, then it becomes conversion by taking. In the case of Macombie versus Davis, the property of a person was taken by an assignment from an agent who was not given authority to dispose of that property. And the person who had taken it refused to give it back to the principal even after it was demanded by the principal. So the agent had assigned the property to some other person and the principal could not take it back, because the person to whom the assignment was done refused to give that property back. So here it was held to be conversion by taking because the person refused to give back the goods and was controlling or exercising a control over it. The next type of conversion is conversion by parting with goods. If a person is entrusted with some goods of another and he gives them to a third person, contrary to the orders, it is a conversion. The essence is that every person who without lawful justification deprives another of his goods by delivering them to someone else so as to change possession is guilty of conversion. So for example, I entrust my goods to X and give them an order to not to give it to somebody else, and he subsequently gives it to Y, X would be liable of conversion by parting with goods because he has acted contrary to my orders and has given the possession to somebody else. So conversion by parting with goods is that giving the goods to somebody else without any orders to do so. The next case, that is the case of Sates versus Hay, will help us better understand the concept of conversion by parting with goods. In this case, X took Y's horse to ride and left the horse at an inn. He is liable for conversion because X can obviously get back his horse, however, he has to pay some amount to the innkeeper. X had not authorized Y to give the horse at an inn. So here, he had parted the goods without any orders or contrary to certain orders, and hence, it is conversion by parting with goods. The next kind of conversion is conversion by sale. If a person wrongfully sells a good, it amounts to conversion. The basic principle here is anybody who, however innocently, obtains possession of goods of a person who has been fraudulently deprived of them and disposes them, whether for his own benefit or that of another, is guilty of conversion. So, if somebody has some goods and they are fraudulently sold, then it amounts to conversion. The case of R.H. Wills and Sons versus British Car Auctions will help us better understand conversion by sale. In this case, the plaintiffs were motor car dealers who sold a car at some cost to Mr. C and obtained a certain amount for it. The full amount was not paid by Mr. C. The plaintiffs had made it clear to Mr. C that he will not sell the car to anybody else before paying the full amount. However, Mr. C sold the car to the defendants, who were auctioneers, without paying the full amount to the plaintiffs. Now, C became bankrupt. The car and the purchaser were not traceable by the plaintiffs. The plaintiffs sued the defendants for conversion and they recovered the damages and the balance price which had to be paid by C for the car. Here, because C was not entitled to sell the car, as he had not paid the full amount, and the contract between plaintiff and C was clear that until the full amount is paid, the car cannot be sold. Hence, the selling of car was illegal and it was considered to be conversion by sale, because he was not yet in lawful possession of the car. Where a man possesses the chattel of somebody else and refuses to give it back to him, this is an assertion of rights which is inconsistent with the right of owner and thus amounts to conversion. So for example, X takes Y's goods and keeps it with him and does not give it back. It is conversion by keeping. Now, if the refusal is qualified or justified or reasonable, so for example, if the refusal is by a person who has kept the goods under custody and demands a payment in return of the custody which was already agreed, then this is not conversion by keeping because it is a justified demand and a justified refusal to give back the goods. However, an unqualified refusal without a reasonable cause is not justified, and it will be a conclusive proof of conversion by keeping. What happens in case of a finder, somebody who finds a good lying or a chattel lying? The rule is that the finder who is not a trespasser, that is, who does not interfere wrongly with the goods, acquires a right to keep it against all but the true owner. So the finder has a right to keep the goods, but his right is subject to those of the owner. If the chattel has been abandoned or lost, and if he takes care and control of the chattel, so the right of the keeper is superior to everybody else except that of the true owner. If the true owner asserts the rights of the goods, then he has to return it back to him. Let us look at certain case laws to understand the concept of conversion by keeping. The first is Armory versus Dalmere. In this case, the plaintiff was a young boy who was a chimney sweeper. He found a very valuable jewel and took it to a jeweler to get its value ascertained. The jeweler wanted to take advantage of the boy and told him that the jewel was worthless and offered him 3 pence for it. However, the boy refused it and demanded the goods back, that is, the jewel back. The jeweler refused to do so. A case for conversion was brought against him, and the court held that it amounted to conversion by keeping because the person refused to give back the goods to him. In this case, since the young boy had found the jewel in the chimney, he had a right over those goods of possession. Only if the true owner of the goods would have come forward and asked for it, was he liable to give it to him. Otherwise, he being the finder, was the keeper of the goods and was entitled to its possession. The next case is that of Han versus Peel. In this case, the defendant was the owner of a house in which he never lived. The house was under requisition, and the plaintiff, who was a soldier, found a brooch in that house which the owner of the house, that is the defendant himself, was not aware of. The plaintiff went to the police and handed the brooch over to them to find out the true owner. The police took the brooch and went to the defendant, and the defendant claimed possession over it. It was held that the plaintiff, who was the finder, was the owner, since the defendant himself did not know about the brooch and the plaintiff had a better title against the brooch than anybody else. Somebody who destroys the chattel of another is liable for conversion by destruction. For example, somebody damages the products of another in such a way that they cannot be used, it is called conversion by destruction. There are certain defenses which can be taken by a person in case of conversion. The first is lien over the goods by the defendant. A lien is the right to possess a good until a debt owed by the person is paid off. So for example, if the defendant holds the goods or the chattel or the property of the plaintiff in lieu of a debt which has to be paid, he can take the defense and he will not be liable for conversion. The next defense is the right of stoppage in transit. The seller of the goods has a right to stop those goods in transit in certain conditions, such as if the payments are not made. This will be dealt in detail in the law of sale of goods in the subsequent courses which you study. So right now it is enough for you to understand that the right to stop the goods in transit while they are being transferred from one place to another due to some circumstances is a good defense for the defendant. The next remedy which is available, or the defense that is which is available to the defendant, is distress. Distress is the right of a landlord to hold the tenant's property till the payment due to him is made. So for example, if the tenant does not pay the rent and the landlord holds certain properties of his, then it will not be considered to be conversion until the amount is paid. Remedy which is available to a plaintiff in case of conversion is the remedy for damages. The quantum of damages paid would depend on the facts and circumstances of the case, depending on the kind of injury which is committed and done to the plaintiff. Having understood the concept of trespass to goods and the concept of conversion, there might be a confusion that what is the difference between conversion and trespass. The first is that trespass to goods is a wider concept than conversion, and trespass to goods includes conversion as a subtype of it. The next is that the essence of trespass is the use of force and the direct injury, whereas conversion is the deprivation of use. So, as we had understood that the deprivation of use and possession of the goods is the essence of conversion, whereas trespass is more than that and includes a wider range, that is any damage or destruction or any other interference in the use of the goods. The next kind of trespass to goods is detenue or detention. This is basically the adverse withholding of goods of another. The tort involves an injury which is not the taking or the misuse of the property, but it's a detention. So the essence of the tort is that the property should be demanded by a person and it should be refused to be given by the person to whom the property is demanded of. The person who gets the property lawfully. So this is how it is different from conversion by keeping. In conversion by keeping, the person may not get the property lawfully. However, here, the person lawfully gets the property and he refuses to give it back to the person to whom he is lawfully bound to give. The remedy given in this case is the recovery of specific goods, and certain special damages are given for the detention which is done of the goods. So, for example, X hands over certain goods to Y to keep in his lawful possession and then demands them back in order to use those goods, but Y refuses to give those goods back. It is considered to be detention because he has refused to give back the goods even when he was lawfully required to give them back. Let us look at what the difference is between trespass and detention. As in the case of conversion, same is the case in trespass and detention, that is, trespass is a wider concept than detention, that is, trespass includes detention. Trespass can be done either by moving or striking or damaging the chattel. However, the main essence of the tort of detention is that there is a refusal by the person to give back the goods. In case of trespass, it is wrongful ab initio, that is, wrongful from the beginning. Whereas in case of detention, the possession is acquired lawfully and there is a refusal to return those goods back. So, this is the difference between trespass to goods and detention. I hope you all have understood the concept of trespass to goods, conversion, various types of conversion, and detention. In case of any doubts, please email me at shruti@mpdnlu.ac.in.